are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
My name is Jerry Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. And this is the Live Garden Show broadcast, where we talk about everything about plants, from apples to zinnias and trees to turf. So if it grows in your garden, we'll talk about it. If it's a weed, if it's a fruit tree, if it's grass, whatever it is, we'll talk about it. So today we're going to talk about citrus. We're going to talk about all the different types of citrus, how to water citrus, how to fertilize them, the pests that citrus get. But if you have a question about your garden, give us a call, 1-800-339-1193. We're going to take a look at a few samples here, a few books, talk a little bit about what I'm going to be planting in my garden in the next week or two, because I'm switching from my summer vegetable materials to my winter vegetables. So we'll talk about that too, and I've been talking about that a little bit every week. Last week we talked about oaks. I do want to show you a book I forgot to bring last week, so we'll look at that real quick. But let's start with our upcoming events. We always like to highlight things that are happening in the horticultural world in Southern California. So you can go out and learn something new, go to one of the botanical gardens, go to a garden club, hear a speaker, get recharged about working in your garden. And today is a wonderful day to work in the garden. The temperatures are down today. It was real hot last weekend. It was pretty hot through the week, but today we're below normal here in Southern California. So we're finally getting our fall weather, but it's the perfect time to start your winter vegetables. So we'll talk about it in a minute. Let's take a look at our upcoming events. And we have the Bonsai Academy will be at the Huntington Library, Art Galleries and Botanic Gardens on October 6th. Oh, that's this week. 10 to 4, that's an all-day event. The Huntington, of course, has an extensive bonsai collection. A lot of it's not even out on public view. They've got a lot of it back in the back. They just don't have enough space to put it all out. So great place to go to learn more about bonsai. It's the ultimate art of pruning. So give them a call at 626-405-2100 if you're interested in attending this all-day event on the 6th. In addition to that, we have the Mount Sac plant sale at Descanso Gardens. This will be October 6th as well from 9 to 4. So this is your opportunity to really pick up some unusual plant materials. You know, they'll probably have some stuff they've propagated in addition to the stuff from Mount Sac. Give them a call. It's an all-day event, 9 to 4. You know, a lot of times if you want an unusual plant material, you have to go to these types of sales, because if you keep going to the, you know, most of the nurseries, you're going to see the same material over and over again. Give them a call, 818-949-4200 for more information about their fall plant sale. In addition to that, let's take a look. We've got the free nature tour at the Fullerton Arboretum on October 8th. That's 10 to 11. And so this is free, and you can go down and see the Arboretum, the Fullerton Arboretum, get a little tour. They'll show you the more interesting aspects of the garden. It's a wonderful garden. Give them a call at 657-278-3407. The Fullerton, of course, has a lot of classes, and they have plant sales. It's just like every other botanical garden or arboretum. So if you're local down there, join the Arboretum, go and take their classes, go to their plant sales, and it will really enrich your gardening experience. And our last upcoming event is plant information. This is the LA County Arboretum on October 5th from 1:30 to 3:30. This is actually a training that they provide to the volunteers. I think Frank McDonough leads this group. And I don't know if they do it monthly or if it's less than monthly, probably monthly. And he'll cover a lot of the issues affecting the garden or affecting anyone's garden in Southern California, but particularly affecting the Arboretum's garden. Give him a call at 657-278-3407. That's kind of an odd phone number, but because I would think they would be either 626. But anyway, 657-278-3407 if you want to attend this plant information session. And So that's our last upcoming event. I was at the gardens yesterday at the Arboretum. I taught a class on tree identification, and I'll be teaching that again in November and again in December. And if I look in my calendar, I'll tell you the dates. We can consider this an extension of our upcoming events. Let's take a look and see when. It's usually the first Saturday in every month. So December, I will be teaching a tree identification class on December 3rd. From 10 to 12, this is a paid class. I had a big turnout yesterday. I had 20, 30 people. We spend an hour looking at trees as a PowerPoint slideshow. So we'll go over about 20 trees, look at the whole tree, the flowers, the bark, talk about anything interesting about the tree, where it's native to, how big it gets, problems the trees might have, reasons not to grow it in your garden, or reasons to grow it in your garden. Then we go out in the garden and go for about an hour hike. But it always turns out to be about an hour and a half hike or walk through the garden. And we stop and look at all the trees we pass by, anything interesting, whether it was in the PowerPoint slideshow or not. So we looked at a lot of different plant materials yesterday. And most people really enjoy the class. It gives them an experience that maybe they haven't had before with tree identification and taking a horticultural course, although brief, 2 to 3 hours. Taking a class and learning something new. So I'll repeating that on, it'll be a different set of trees that we'll talk about. That'll be December 3rd. That's December 3rd, but November will be probably the first Saturday in November, which is going to be the 5th. So it's November 5th and December 3rd, if you're interested in coming out and learning more about trees. So before we talk about citrus, I got a couple of things. I got our mystery plant or object that we like to have you call in and take a guess what this is. Let's go to the overhead, I guess, and we'll take a look at this, and then we'll look at some samples I brought in this morning. I always like to bring in samples from my lab. If you don't know what I do, I'm a plant pathologist, and I have a plant diagnostic laboratory, and I work for the LA County Ag Commissioner. So what is this thing? I'll give you some tips. This is obviously wood. And it's probably either from Indonesia or perhaps Bali. In the past, I've said Africa, and there probably some of these come from Africa too. But if you look them up on the internet, they talk more about them coming from Indonesia. And let me see if I can show you the whole thing pretty clearly. This is been cleaned of the bark and sanded, but this is all natural. This is not cut with a saw or anything. This is natural. You can buy these when you travel to the parts of the world where they occur. The local people cut them off the tree. This is wood, so obviously this is a branch off a tree. And then they clean them up. But what is it called? What's the common name for it? And what is it? Why does it look like this? What is this odd-looking thing? It's not really a club to clonk people in the head. It's a decorative item at this point. But it's a very interesting decorative item. And a friend of mine gave it to me years ago because she said, hey, you're an arborist, you're a tree person, you should have this. So she gave it to me. It was very generous of her. And it's kind of one of my prized little trinkets that I have around the house because it's so interesting. So that's our mystery object. Here it is. You could hit somebody in the head with it. I don't recommend it. So I'm going to leave that right there. Let me shove it over here so you can actually get a good look at it. And let's take a look at some samples that came in today. We're going to save this one just for a few minutes, but let's look at these camellia leaves. We've talked about camellias a few times in the past. Camellias, of course, are very common shrub material. Beautiful flowers in the winter. If it doesn't rain, you don't get the camellia flower blight. They do well. But take a look at these leaves. Let's go to the overhead. And we'll see this damage. Now, you can see these leaves here. Have a nice green color, and they're shiny. You see how shiny that is? And I'll confess, I wiped off the dust because they get pretty dusty. Plants get real dusty if they don't get washed off. So there's probably still dust all over them. And that's just a reminder, periodically you should wash off your plants, maybe every 2 to 4 weeks in the summer. You just rinse them off, get the dust off them. It's really good for them to dust them off, clean the dust off. But these leaves look nice and healthy. Take a look at these leaves, and you can see they don't look so good, particularly, these lower leaves. You see there, we call this bronzing, where the center here is all discolored and kind of grayed out or bronzed. And you can see all these leaves have done this, but if you take a look at maybe the newest growth, it may not have it. No, it doesn't. You see this new growth looks pretty good. Well, this is caused by the camellia mite. This is camellia. If I've been saying citrus, I apologize. Camellia. This is Camellia japonica. There's about 200 species of camellias. Japonica is the one everyone grows for the most part. So anyway, this is the symptoms you're going to see from the camellia mite. It's an aerophytid mite, which are a strange group of mites. And normally, you would expect aerophytid mites to cause galling. It's quite common in that group. In this case, they feed on the tender young growth as it comes out in the spring, and they damage the epidermis of the leaf and cause it to be kind of grayed or silvered or, you know, rusted. So how do you control this? Well, it's not hard to control mites. Soapy water and oil is pretty effective. Usually early spring, you want to get it on there. If you have any old pesticides, particularly something like diazinon, which is no longer on for sale, but if you've got some around, it's particularly good at controlling mites. And I used it a lot when I curated the camellia collection at the Huntington. So that's the camellia mite. These leaves also look pretty good. And these look pretty good. So anyway, that's the camellia mite. And it's too late to do anything to these leaves that have the symptoms. The mites are probably already gone. The mites are actually, as you might expect, mites are really tiny. They're even hard to see with a hand lens. You pretty much need a microscope to get a good look at a mite. You can see the damage that mites cause, and if you know your host and recognize the damage, you don't really need to see the mite. You know what it is. So now the other thing that we had come in was this, and this is our leaves from Quercus lobata, and we talked about Quercus lobata last week, as a matter of fact. That is the valley oak or the California white oak. It is in the white oak group. But let's take a closer look at this, and I'm going to put on my glasses so I can see it clearly too. Come on in and come in close on the overhead. Here we go. And you can see that there's some fungal growth on here and some browning of the leaves. And this is powdery mildew. And powdery mildew is pretty common on a variety of oaks. And so you can see it's doing the damage there. So this white growth here is one of the powdery mildews. And of course, powdery mildews are fairly host specific. They don't really go, so the one that you get here off of oak is not going to affect something like a rose bush. That's a completely different fungus that causes powdery mildew on rose bushes. Now, generally speaking, these powdery mildews on native trees are insignificant. They're not important. There's no reason to go and spray your tree for powdery mildew. It's a naturally occurring fungus. Of some years it may get worse than others, but the tree can handle it. So if you want to spray, you could, very early spring, you might use, sulfur or something, but if you had a small new tree, you might want to control it. That might be far more reasonable. But if you got a big 50-foot tree, spraying it's going to be very expensive. The powdery mildew is not that important. That's what you need to learn when you're managing trees, what's important and what's not important. Should you spend your resources and money dealing with something that's insignificant, or you should spend your resources and money on taking care of the important aspects of tree care. Now, before I go to my, in fact, I'm going to save this sample for later in the talk after we talk about all the other things about citrus, because this is a citrus sample I want to show you. But let's just talk a little bit about what you could be planting in your garden this winter. All your summer materials are going to be petering out pretty quickly. If you still have tomatoes, producing tomatoes, good for you. That's great. But as we get cold nights, those green tomatoes just aren't going to ripen. So unless you have a hothouse and you can keep them warm, your fruit will just stay green. And then if we get, more and more into the winter and we get a real cold night, and we actually get a freeze, if you live in an area that you can get a freeze, say you're up in Altadena or Sierra Madre or La Cañada, where you're very likely to get a freeze, as opposed to being in Santa Monica, where you're not going to get any freezing weather. So really depends on where you are. But, that summer material is really finishing up, whether you're growing peppers or tomatoes. Let's think what else. You could grow corn and melons and squash and a lot of stuff. Summer vegetable garden, wide palette offered, up that you can grow. Let's take a look at these these seed packs I have here, and I'll show you what I'm going to be growing. These are snap peas. This is this one is sugar ant, and this is super sugar snap. So both of these are edible pod. You eat the whole pod. They're called snap peas or sugar snaps. One of my favorites to grow in the garden. So it's time to get them in the ground. I want to get them in the ground before we get any colder at night. I want to get them in the ground when the soil is still fairly warm, and then they'll germinate pretty fast. They'll come up and they'll start growing, and maybe I'll be picking peas. Well, if I get them in now, maybe Christmas, New Year's, I might even have some peas to pick. And the other thing to plant right now would be sugar peas, sweet peas, which are for flowers. You don't eat sweet peas, you grow them for flowers. These are edible peas. And then cabbage. Cabbage is any heading crop, heading lettuce, cabbage, cauliflower, broccoli. All those are excellent winter crops. So if you want to grow cabbage, now's the time to seed it in and let it head up. Another fun thing to do with this is grow too much and then chop it up and mix it in the soil green. And that's an organic way to fumigate your soil. The cabbage, it has a lot of sulfur in it, and when it decomposes, it gives off products that kill fungi and nematodes, and it's a good way. So if you've had problems in your soil with nematodes or soil-borne fungal diseases like phytophthora root rot, rhizoctonia, verticillium, fusarium, whatever your problem is, cabbage is a good way to organically fumigate your soil. So this is your opportunity. A lot of people say, I have limited full sun. I have to grow my tomatoes in the same place every year. Okay, well now it's time to grow some cabbage, turn it into the soil, let it rot, tarp it down, let it rot in the soil for 2 or 3 weeks, pull the tarp, turn the soil to let it air out, and then you want to have that all finished up by, about March 15th of next year, and you put your tomatoes back in. And they'll do much better because you'll suppress all those soil-borne pathogens. So cilantro is another one of my favorites for the winter. It's absolutely, essential when I'm making burritos or all sorts of Mexican dishes. So it's also coriander. You see here it says coriander. So the leaves, these are the juvenile leaves here. And it will, if you grow it now, it will only grow juvenile leaves. As the days get longer and longer and you get into the spring, eventually it will start to grow the mature foliage, which is very frilly and looks like a fern. And that has very little flavor to it. These leaves have very strong flavor, the cilantro flavor. And then if you let it flower and make the seed, and the seed is coriander, you can grind it up and use that as an herb as well. But if you want to grow the cilantro, the juvenile leaves, now's the time to plant it. And seed is great. I don't know how many seeds are in here, but I could grow enough cilantro for a bunch of families with just one pack of seed. And of course, lettuce. You can grow lettuce year-round, but of course it does best in the winter months when it doesn't flower, because it'll flower pretty quickly in the summer months. And these are mixes. Now, I'm not promoting anyone's particular seed brand. You can get your seed from anywhere you want. But what I want to do with these is you can see there's a number of varieties of different kinds of lettuce in both packs. So I'm going to grow this. Some of it, of course, I'll be eating in salads. And others, I will go ahead and let them bolt. I'll let them flower at some point, probably next spring. And then I'm going to collect the seed from them, and I'm not going to need to buy the seeds again. I've got a lot of Black Simpson's seed, black-seeded Simpson, which is a very nice lettuce. I don't know if I've got any of the Butter Crunch, but those, winter is a great time to grow a bunch of different kinds of lettuce because it won't bloom. And like I said, in the summer, they tend to flower, and once they start to flower, they get pretty bitter. And then they put all their energy into flowering, and the leaves are not in such good shape anymore. So that's some tips on what to grow for winter. And, I wanted to show you this book, Oaks of California. This is what I wanted to show you last week, and I forgot to. So we have about 18 native oaks in California. Last week we talked about all the different kinds of oaks, the white oaks, the red / black oaks, the golden or intermediate oaks. And this is Oaks of California. It's published by the California Oak Foundation. It runs around $30. I don't know if you need to buy it, but you could probably go to the Arboretum and look at it in their library. I imagine they have a copy. But what's really nice is there's a section on every species. They've got pictures showing you the various aspects of the trees, show you the leaves and the fruit. Let me just see if I can open it up to one of the species. They talk about the role of, the ecological role of oaks, and then of course they go into all the different species. So let's see here. And they'll show you their distribution. Oh, I guess they do it by region. Let's see, where's the section on all the species? I guess it's at the beginning of the book. So anyway, nice book on oaks, Oaks of California from the California Oak Foundation. Good book. There's also, if you look up in your Sunset Western Garden book, there's a really good section. Here's your Sunset Western Garden book, really good section on oaks. Just look it up under Quercus, the genus name. Of course, today we're going to talk about citrus, so let's take a look at a couple of books on citrus. This is the Integrated Pest Management for Citrus, second edition from the University of California. This is one of your best books on how to grow citrus in California. It talks about everything, every aspect of growing citrus in California. It talks about all the insect pests. It talks about all the fungal or all the diseases of citrus, bacterial, fungal, and virus. Then it'll talk about watering, site selection, fertilization, grafting, you know, all the different aspects of citrus. And these run around $35. I don't know if you need one in your library, but you can actually get the same information by going to the UC IPM website and clicking on agricultural pests, and then you'll get a list of all the crops, click on citrus, and then you get a list of every disease and insect that occurs on citrus. So, excellent book on citrus from the University of California. Here's our next one. This is the Compendium of Citrus Diseases, and this is from the American Phytopathological Society. So this only covers diseases. It really doesn't talk about anything but diseases. So it doesn't talk about insects very much, only if it has some relation to the disease. And it doesn't really talk about site selection, watering, fertilizing, pruning. It's really just diseases. But it's really an excellent book, and it's also it's really worldwide. Any disease that occurs on citrus will be in here. And so some of those diseases may not really occur in California or are not significant in California, but this is really an excellent compendium of citrus diseases. And the American Phytopathological Society, or APS Press, has about 35 of these compendiums on all sorts of different kinds of crops. So they've got a compendium of rose diseases, a compendium on corn diseases, on cucurbits, on really everything you can think of, potato and tomato. They've got it. So let's see what we want to do next. Let's talk about citrus. What do you know? We finally get to our main subject. And what is citrus? And where'd they come from? And all that good stuff. So let's bring up our first picture behind me so we'll know what we're talking about. Here it is, showing you a beautiful flower. You know, citrus are extremely fragrant. Of course, this is an orange. I'm trying to see if it's probably a Valencia, or I don't see the navel on it, but let's talk about citrus. So the citrus family is called the Rutaceae, or the Rue family, sometimes also called just the citrus family, but the Rutaceae is the family that citrus belongs to. Of course, there's other genera within the family, but so those are what we consider related genera. All citrus trees are of the single genus Citrus and remain largely interbreedable. That is, there's only one, in a way, one superspecies, which includes grapefruits, lemons, limes, and oranges. It is believed and supported with molecular studies that citron, pomelo, mandarin, and papadeus were the ancestors of all other citrus species and their varieties as they resulted from breeding or natural hybridization among the parental species. So currently it's believed, you can come back to me, it's believed that there's only four original species of citrus and that everything we're growing derived from those original four species. And citrus are incredibly hybridizable, or they will cross easily. So you can cross oranges. In fact, an orange tree is probably a hybrid. And you can cross, you see, cross them all. So you can cross a lemon with an orange and take the seed, and you're going to get a new fruit, or a different kind of a fruit. And it's been done repeatedly. That's why we have so many different kinds of citrus fruit. So the orange tree is Citrus sinensis. The lemon is Citrus X limon. The X indicates a hybrid. Grapefruit is Citrus, it should be X paradisi. Grapefruit is a hybrid. Lime, mostly Citrus arantifolia, and also the key lime is another citrus. Let's see, so the precise number of natural species is actually not really clear, but it is believed there's four originals. Natural and cultivated origin hybrids include commercially important fruit. Okay, we know that. Now the kumquats are a group of small fruit-bearing trees in the Rutaceae, and their genus is Fortinella. So kumquats are citrus fruit. I mean, they really are citrus in a way, but they're not in the same genus. It's in Fortinella. And some people may want to include Fortinella as, you know, just move them in and call them citrus. And so some people do that. Sweet orange is Citrus sinensis. And so we just saw a picture of sweet orange. Let's take a look at some more pictures of oranges, and we'll talk about oranges. The orange is a hybrid of ancient cultivated origin, possibly between pomelo, Citrus maxima, and tangerine, Citrus reticulata. So oranges originated in Southeast Asia. The fruit of Citrus sinensis is called sweet orange to distinguish it from Citrus aurantium, the bitter orange, which is incredibly bitter, by the way. The Persian orange, grown widely in Southern Europe, and after its introduction to Italy in the 11th century, was bitter. That's the bitter orange, Citrus aurantium. Sweet oranges brought to Europe in the 15th century from India by Portuguese traders quickly displaced the bitter and are now the most common variety of oranges cultivated. So Portuguese, Spanish, Arab, and Dutch sailors planted citrus trees along trade routes to prevent scurvy. As most of you probably know, citrus is very high in vitamin C. Let's take a look at this next picture, and you can all salivate a little bit. You know, orange juice. What a day without orange juice is like a day without sunshine, which must be a lot like night, I guess. So anyway, it's very high in vitamin C. They were intentionally planted along trade routes so that sailors could eat citrus and avoid scurvy. On his second voyage in 1493, Christopher Columbus brought the seeds of oranges, lemons, and citrons to Haiti and the Caribbean. So they were introduced a long time ago, though. They were introduced in Florida in 1513 by Spanish explorer Juan Ponce de Leon, and were introduced to Hawaii in 1792. The navel orange has an unbelievably interesting story. Let's take a look at our next picture. And you can see a navel orange. And almost all of us know what a navel orange is. A navel orange has a second fruit at the base, and that is what causes the navel on the exterior on the rind. So the navel orange was discovered in 1820 in Bahia, Brazil, when a mutation occurred in a grove of sweet orange trees. In 1872, Brazil sent a dozen navel orange seedlings to the U.S. Department of Agriculture in Washington, D.C. The next year, Mrs. Eliza Tibbetts of Riverside was given actually two seedlings from the USDA, and the seedlings began producing fruit in 1878. This variety of orange became known as the Riverside Orange, but the name was changed to Washington as a marketing ploy for national appeal. Other varieties of the navel orange include Atwoods, Thompson, Fisher, Lane Late, and today there are many, many varieties of navels. Navels are nearly seedless. They have a thick rind. They were very popular. By 1882, over 500,000 citrus trees were growing in California. This time in history became known as the Other California Gold Rush, which established the citrus industry in California. Today, the parent Washington navel orange tree still stands in Riverside, though it was transplanted in 1902 from its original home to a different location, and it's still there today. Despite its age, this tree, which is now protected, continues to bear fruit. So that mutation actually caused the second fruit to develop at the base of the original fruit. It's like conjoined twins. And so on the outside, it looks like it has a human navel. And it also, the mutation also left the fruit seedless and therefore sterile. And generally speaking, you get no seeds in a navel. And occasionally you do get a seed. And that's from pollen from another tree somewhere, probably from a bee visiting the tree. And so if you grow that, it's not going to be exactly like the tree you're growing. That's how we get new varieties of navels. So the Washington navel, widely adapted except in desert, best in interior, early to midwinter. And Caracara is a rosy flesh navel, early to midwinter with a very rich flavor. Lane Late is a late ripening navel into the summer. And Skaggs Bonanza colors early, heather bearing, but very short-lived. In fact, Skaggs Bonanza was a disaster. And I don't think anyone grows it anymore. And you don't want to grow it either. It was under a lot of stress for whatever reason. And the fruit would color up in November, but the fruit's not ripe. Now, the thing about navels is they reach their peak of flavor in January and February. So if we get cold nights and they start turning orange, that doesn't mean they're sweet. That just, the rind is coloring up, but don't pick them until January. Now, you might be able to pick them in December and they'll be okay. But if you pick them in November, they're not gonna be sweet. And that's what the problem with Skaggs Bonanza. People were, the growers were picking them in November when they colored up and getting triple the price you'd get for them a month or two later. But they were tasteless. They were really just blah. And so it kind of soured people on oranges for the rest of the season. You went and you bought oranges and they didn't taste good. Are you going to buy more? No, you're going to go buy bananas and apples. But the thing that kind of saved the citrus industry a little bit was Skaggs Bonanzas. They die when they get about 12 to 13 years. They go into decline because the reason they were coloring up is they were very stressed. They have a graft compatibility problem with the scion and the rootstock. And so that's why they're stressed, and that's why they color up early. And then the other consequence is after about 12 years, your yield drops like crazy and the trees are doing badly. Let's talk about Valencia. The Valencia orange is a sweet orange, mostly used for juicing. It has a thinner rind. It has seeds. Let's see here. I've got some misinformation that I got. But the Valencia's name comes from Valencia, in Spain. It's believed that they originated on the Azores Islands, cataloged in 1865 under the name Excelsior. So it's gone through a bunch of name changes. In 1870, trees were provided to S.P. Parsons and Long Island nurserymen, and in 1876, they sent trees to a Chapman of San Gabriel, California. It was later realized that the trees that were coming into California or into the United States with a variety of names were the same things being grown in Spain under the name Valencia oranges. So at that point in time, the people started calling it all Valencia oranges, and all these other names dropped away. So the difference between, and the odd thing about Valencia oranges is they are summer oranges. Most of the citrus we grow is ripe in the winter, December, January, February. You can still pick into March, into April, but you know, 4 months on the tree and you want to be getting all your fruit off the tree by then. But Valencias won't be ripe until June, July, August. They've got to be on the tree about 16 months up to 18 months to ripen. So your Valencias will color up during the winter, but they're not sweet until June or July. So if you have Valencias, don't be picking them in December and January. They're not going to taste good. So like I said, it's a late season fruit, a popular variety when the navel oranges are out of season. Name comes from the Spanish city of Valencia. Orange was later sold to Irvine Company, and of course it was widely grown in California too, but you know, California oranges are mostly fresh market oranges. In Florida, the oranges often don't color up well. They don't get the cold nights in the winter that actually stimulate the rind turning orange. So they turn a light green when they're ripe. Plus, they got a lot of insect problems in Florida. It's a tropical environment, it's humid, it's wet. It's very conducive for a lot of insect activity, and you get a lot of rind damage. So they don't look clean. And I was stunned about, 3 to 6 months ago, we intercepted a lot of oranges coming from Florida. And when I opened the box and looked at them, it was fruit you would never see for sale in California because of the rind damage. But that's what fresh market oranges look like in Florida. They're not very, the rind's all damaged, but the fruit is delicious. So in California, we have very clean oranges, really with no rind damage. Of course, they're sorted at the packing house. If there is rind damage, it never makes it to the store. Those just are culls, or they're used for some other purpose. So, let's see. So, of course, Orange County was named after oranges, but there isn't a lot of production down there anymore because most of those orange groves were turned into housing, and the bulk of oranges are grown in the Central Valley, up in the Bakersfield area. California has probably about 60 to 70,000 acres of citrus in production. Florida had a lot more production in acreage, probably in the close to 500,000 acre range, so much larger production. But almost all of that was for juice production. And there's probably only one juicing plant left in California, or maybe a couple at the most. So Valencias are the most widely planted orange in the world, because it is picked in the summer. There's a handful of varieties. There's Campbell, Delta, Midnight. These are early ripening and nearly seedless. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is the blood orange. This is one of my favorite oranges. The flavor is just phenomenal. Let's just go ahead and click through a few of these pictures while I tell you about them. The blood orange is a variety of Citrus sinensis with crimson blood-colored flesh. Take a look at our next picture. The distinctive dark flesh color is due to the presence of anthocyanin, a pigment common to many flowers and fruit, but fairly uncommon in citrus. The blood orange is often described as a hybrid between a pomelo and a tangerine, but is actually just a mutation of a sweet orange, except sweet oranges are a hybrid between pomelo and tangerine. The three most common types of blood oranges are Tarocco, native to Italy, Sanguinello, native to Spain, and the Moro, the newest variety of the three. The Moro, a recent addition to the blood orange family, is the most colorful of the three types with deep purple flesh and reddish orange rind. Let's take a look at our next picture. And these make some of the best juice you've ever tasted in your life. Now, it's never really reached large commercial success. You just rarely see blood oranges for sale in supermarkets. You see them a lot at the farmers markets because that's the kind of thing farmers markets can really make money on. Take a look at our next picture. This is a Smith Red. Look at how dark red that is. The flavor is absolutely phenomenal. So you can come on back to me. So the Moro is believed to have originated at the beginning of the 19th century in the citrus growing areas around Lentini in Sicily as a bud mutation of the Sanguinano. The Tarocco is a medium-sized fruit and perhaps the sweetest and most flavorful of the three types. Sanguinello is also called Sanguinelli in the U.S. It's a Sicilian common name. Discovered in Spain in 29, a reddish skin, few seeds, sweet and tender flesh. Blood oranges cultivated in the United States are in season from December to March. It's a winter, just like almost all citrus are winter ripe. So December to March in Texas, November to May in California. We have an extended season here. While the tree will grow and bear fruit in Florida, the Mediterranean temperature variation between day and night seems to be necessary to develop the red color. That's absolutely true. You get much better red color. You know, it doesn't really color up until you get some real cold nights in the fall. That's when it starts to color up. So you don't get the color in Florida. So they don't do well there. So the sour orange is Citrus aurantium. It is a bitter orange, also called the Seville orange. There's really no reason to grow it. There's a good grove of them at the Arboretum if you want to taste one. And I've tasted them there, and I've tasted them in Spain as well, because I was traveling in Spain one time, and as oranges all over these trees, the street trees, and I picked one, unbelievably bitter. I mean, you expect this sweet orange. It's orange, it looks great. They're very seedy too, lots of seed. So not really anything most people would be interested in. The grapefruit, of course, grapefruits are fabulous. Let's take a look at our next picture. Grapefruit is Citrus X Paradisi, grown for its bitter fruit, which is originally named the forbidden fruit of Barbados. First documented in 1750 by the Reverend Griffith Hughes, describing specimens from Barbados. It had developed as a hybrid of the pomelo, Citrus maxima, and the sweet orange, Citrus sinensis, although it is closer to the pomelo. The grapefruit was known as the Shaddock or Shaddock until the 1800s. Taken from the name of Captain Shaddock, who introduced the pomelo to the Caribbean from Polynesia in the 17th century. Its current name alludes to clusters of fruit on the tree, which often appear similar to grapes. That's right, it's called a grape fruit, not a great fruit. And it's because they cluster like grapes. Botanically, it was not distinguished from the pomelo until the 1830s when it was named Citrus X Paradisi. The 1929 Ruby Red patent was associated with the first real commercial success for grapefruits, which came from after the discovery of a red grapefruit growing on a pink variety. And that's, you know, it's interesting. Come on back to me. You know, citrus and a lot of fruits, a lot of trees and plants in general, will do what's called sporting, which means one branch on the tree or shrub will either have different leaves or a slightly different flower or a slightly different fruit from the rest of the tree. And that's because when that branch started to grow and it was just a bud, there was a mutation in that bud. Then the branch grows out and you'll have these differences. Usually, especially on citrus, that's not a good thing. That you don't want to propagate from that branch because it'll have defects in the fruit, like a ridge, like a little raised section of the rind running halfway around the fruit. That's not a beneficial change. But a lot of our varieties, the navel orange was a bud mutation off a sweet orange. And so The red grapefruit was a bud mutation off a pink grapefruit. But that ruby red is just a fabulous fruit. Now, grapefruits need a lot of heat to sweeten. So historically, grapefruits were always grown in the desert, out in the Coachella area. You can grow them fine in the inland valleys, but if you're going to grow them right along the coast, you're going to have to buy some specialized varieties that do well in a cooler climate. They do best where you get very hot days and cool nights, especially in the fall. Otherwise, they just are sour and they never get any sweetness to them at all. And of course, they are a little bit sour. So Rio Red is the current Texas grapefruit that was 2007. Registered trademarks Rio Star and Ruby Sweet, also sometimes promoted as the reddest and Texas choice. A grapefruit can have a number of interactions with drugs, often increasing the effective potency of compounds. So if you are on a prescription and you are not supposed to eat any grapefruit when you are taking prescription medications, some people ended up quite ill because even though they were taking the correct amount according to their prescription, when you eat grapefruit with it, you increase the absorption of that pharmaceutical drug, and then you get too much, and it can make you quite ill. In fact, it can actually kill you, depending on what the prescription is. There is also the grapefruit diet, the theory being that the fruit's low glycemic index is able to help the body's metabolism burn fat. I will warn you, do not eat a whole bunch of grapefruits thinking that that's going to be a pleasant experience. With a lot of fruit, moderation. If you eat a whole bunch of grapefruits, you're likely to get diarrhea, just like if you ate a whole bunch of any other kind of fruit. Fruits do that to you. So a little bit of fruit's good, a whole lot of fruit, and well, it won't kill you, but you will regret it. So the effect of grapefruit juice with regard to drug absorption was originally discovered in 1989. Well publicized after being responsible for a number of deaths due to overdosing on medications. So yes, it can be fatal. So the varieties of grapefruit, Flame as seedless red flesh, Marsh, Maine white flesh commercial variety, very large. Meligold, this is one of the low temperature grapefruits. Needs less heat, fruit does not hold well on the tree though. Oro Blanco is the sister to Meligold and is very good for along the coast. Sweeter seedless white flesh. And then the really favorites, the red blush, the ruby red, seedless grapefruit with red tinted flesh, fades to pink by end of season. Rio Red is seedless, good rind blush, nearly as red as Star Ruby, more dependable to producer than Star Ruby. And then Stat Ruby, seedless, reddish color, prone to cold damage. So this is one that would do well maybe in the inland valleys, but maybe you don't want out in the desert because the desert can get harder freezes than say the San Gabriel Valley. But the Stat Ruby is erratic bearing, does not withstand desert heat. So this is clearly better for an interior valley. Now, I do have a video from the Riverside Citrus Collection. I want to go to that now. Out in Riverside, you've got the USDA Germplasm Repository for citrus. And they have probably in excess of 600 varieties. That was the last time I heard. And then I heard recently 1,100 varieties. So I'm not sure how many they really have, but a lot. So let's take a look at this little video clip for the next 6 minutes or so. And then we'll come back and we'll look at more sections from the curator for the Citrus Germplasm Repository at UC Riverside. Let's take a look at this clip.
Hi, I'm Tom Spellman with Dave Wilson Nursery. Today, we're going to take a tour of the Citrus Experiment Station at UC Riverside. It's been in existence for over 100 years. It has a varietal collection of well over 1,000 citrus varieties. And I thought it would be interesting to start at kind of a historic point in the citrus industry. Right behind me is the original parent navel orange tree planted here in Riverside in 1873. So it's been here now for 136 years. This is an area that at one time was an orange grove, a flourishing orange grove. And now it's right in the middle of the city, as you can tell by the traffic going around me. This tree is actually a living landmark here in the state of California, and a cherished landmark at that. It's historic landmark number 20. It's maintained by the varietal collection group at UC Riverside. They work on this tree all the time to keep it healthy. In fact, back in the 1980s, this tree was actually inarched in saying the tree was not healthy, the tree was dying, and it was losing its root system to root rot. So what the university did was they brought in seedlings of other citrus varieties planted them around the base of the tree and actually grafted them up into the base of the tree to keep it alive. So here it is, beautiful landmark, 136 years old, the original navel orange tree, where all navel oranges have come from that are in existence today. We're talking about the parent of millions of trees. And we're going to go to the varietal collection now, and we're going to see some phenomenal, unusual citrus varieties today. This morning, we're out on the UC Riverside Citrus Varietal Collection Block. This is our friend Robert Kruger. He's the curator of the USDA Germplasm Block of Citrus here in Riverside.
Thanks, Tom. We are located here at the UC Riverside Citrus Variety Collection, which we use as a field collection for our efforts in genetic resource conservation. The variety collection is over 100 years old at this point and has moved around here in Riverside over the decades from across town to different places on the citrus experiment station. We currently have about 1,100 different types of citrus and related genera. So today we're going to take a look at some of the more unusual types of citrus that we have here that might be of interest to people.
Tom, this is the Buddha's Hand Citron. Citrons are one of our basic types of citrus, and they originated around the area of southern China or northern India. And what's interesting about the Buddha's Hand is that developmentally, in the development of the citrus fruit, normally when you cut open a citrus fruit, you see the different segments. With the Buddha's Hand, they never fuse during the fruit development process, and so they stay open like that. And if you cut them open, which we'll do here, you'll see they have no flesh in them. What's interesting about a lot of these citrons is, not necessarily this one, even though they have no flesh, the rind is slightly sweet. And we'll go ahead and I'll take a taste of this one. I don't believe this is one of the sweeter rinds, though. It's not the sweetest rind I've tasted, but it does have a little bit of flavor there.
Well, one thing that I've always liked to use citron for, especially the Buddha's Hand, number one, they're ornamentally just a unique piece of fruit to use as a display in the house. But unfortunately, on camera, you can't pick this up, but the fragrance is just phenomenal. It's a very fresh, light, citrusy flavor, and the aroma of a fruit will just permeate and fill an entire room.
Tom, this is the Australian finger lime. This is actually traditionally been classified as a related species, microcitrus, because it's basically a smaller tree. Some of the recent taxonomic work has pulled this back into citrus. In any case, these are native to some of the desert areas in Australia, and they are sometimes consumed in Australia. If you cut them open, you can see a lot of these little small juice vesicles and small seeds, and they have a somewhat limey flavor, and hence they're called the finger lime, and they have a related rounder one, which is the Australian desert lime. These are becoming more of interest to chefs to use as a garnish.
One of the things that my wife and I have done with these in the past is use them as a sprinkle garnish over salads and also over cheesecake. Very, very nice enhancement on cheesecake.
This is Citrus hystrix, also called Kufre lime, and it's a pepita, so it's a little bit different than regular citrus. The pepitas have leaves with a very large petiole in comparison to regular citrus, and they also have more pronounced oil glands. This fruit is not edible, but the leaves are used in Southeast Asian cooking as a condiment. And the fruit, as I said, it's something that we don't eat because it's very pungent, very astringent. But traditionally, they would make a shampoo for it that was supposed to have some sort of insecticidal qualities to it. And so it tastes like a strongly flavored lemon or lime.
Yeah, and again, the aromatics of this variety are just incredible. The crushed leaf has a wonderful fragrance, and the fruit, the fragrance just permeates the area right here. It's a very, very incredible smell.
I'd like to, something to note about this particular tree is the presence of our yellow sticky trap. We have some invasive pests of citrus that are now threatening the California citrus industry, so we want to remain vigilant to find these pests. The Asian citrus psyllid is a carrier of the citrus Wanlong Bing disease, which can be very devastating to a citrus industry, so we want to exclude these pests from California. And these leaves of citrus hystrix are something that's commonly smuggled in from other countries to use in specific types of restaurants. So, please remain vigilant that you try to avoid smuggling any fruit or citrus leaves into the country.
So his last point is really important because unfortunately people do smuggle in budwood from Asia, from China, Southeast China, from Taiwan, and that's probably how we got citrus greening in California. We'll talk about citrus greening in a minute, but let's finish up talking about the grapefruits. They need heat for sweet tart fruit, best in desert where fruit ripens in 9 months. Rio Red is the current Texas grapefruit. I think we did this, I'm repeating myself. We've got Flame, Marsh, Mellow Gold, Oro Blanco, Red Blush, so we went over those. So let's now talk a little bit about lemons. Lemons are Citrus X Limon, another hybrid, actually. The exact origin of the lemon has remained a mystery. In the 1700s and 1800s, lemons were increasingly planted in Florida and California, where when lemons began to be used in cooking and flavoring, though it was widely presumed that lemons first grew in India, northern Burma, and China. It was later introduced to Persia and then to Iraq and Egypt around AD 700. This is, again, one of those fruits and citrus in general that have been grown for thousands of years. The lemon was first recorded in literature in a 10th century Arabic thesis on farming and was also used as an ornamental plant in early Islamic gardens. Distributed widely throughout the Arab world and the Mediterranean region around AD 1000 and AD 1150, lemons entered Europe no later than the first century AD during the time of ancient Rome. Later introduced to the Americas in 1493 when Christopher Columbus brought lemon seeds to Hispaniola along his voyages. 1700s and late 1800s, lemons were increasingly planted in Florida and California. James Lind, in 1747, experiments on seamen suffering from scurvy involved adding vitamin C to their diets through lemon juice. The Eureka is the standard lemon of markets, bears year-round to 20 feet with very few thorns. The Lisbon is a vigorous upright with many thorns, 20 to 25 feet tall. Now, you don't want to let them get that big. Just because a tree will grow to 20 or 25 feet doesn't mean you need to let it get that big. You want to keep your fruit trees to 12 to 15 feet so you can pick the fruit. The Lisbon, the fruit is nearly identical to Eureka. The ripens mostly in the fall, some fruit year-round. This is the Lisbon is the best lemon for Arizona. If you want to grow a lemon here, I would recommend the Eureka. The Meyer lemon, actually a cross between a lemon and possibly an orange or a mandarin, named for Frank Meyer, discovered it in 1908. But it is, I don't like the Meyer lemon. It's too sweet. If I wanted a sweet fruit, I'll eat an orange or a tangerine. If I want a lemon, I get a real lemon. The Meyer is thin-skinned and less acidic than the Lisbon and Eureka lemons, and proved Meyer is disease-resistant. The Ponderosa is a huge, rough lemon with thick, coarse skin, up to 2 pounds, very mild flavor. Sun Gold is an attractive semi-dwarf with green-striped yellow fruit. And variegated pink is a sport of Eureka with green and white leaves and green stripes on immature fruit. Let's take a look at our next picture. And this is the pink variegated Eureka lemon. And now, as it ripens, of course, the flesh is pink, but the green streaks that you see here will disappear as it ripens. So you really see them mostly when it's immature. Now let's talk about the lime. The lime is Citrus arantifolia, and of course, I love limes. I use them slices in various drinks, just in water, and you can put slices of lemon in water, and it just really makes it much more delicious. Lime is a term referring to a number of different fruits, actually, both species and hybrids, which are typically round, green to yellow in color, 3 to 6 centimeters in diameter, generally containing a sour pulp and frequently associated with the lemon. Bear's lime is the best lime for California and Hawaii, a type of Persian lime or Tahitian lime commonly growing in Florida. Very thorny, seedless, drops many leaves in the winter. In fact, there are deciduous form citrus. You saw the Buddha's hand. Buddha's hand is deciduous. In the winter, it drops all its leaves. So you often think that all citrus are going to be evergreen, and they're not. Some citrus are actually deciduous. Some of the rootstocks are also deciduous. So the Bear's lime is green when immature and yellow-green when ripe. So that's the most common citrus. There's a bunch of other limes, but if you really want a good lime, just a regular lime, the Bear's lime is the one you want. Let's talk about pomelo now. Let's take a look. There you see that lime right there. And let's talk about pomelo. Go to our next picture. The pomelo is Citrus Maxima, and that is a species. It's not considered to be a hybrid. Native to Southeast Asia. Pale green to yellow when ripe, with sweet white or more rarely pink or red flesh and very thick spongy rind. Look at how thick that rind is. It's unbelievable. I think grapefruits are better, and I know they're very popular in the Asian community. It is the largest citrus fruit, ranging in size from an extra large grapefruit to the diameter of a basketball, and usually weighing between 1 and 2 kilograms, which is really 2 to 4 or 5 pounds. Other names for pomelo include pomelo, pomelo, Chinese grapefruit, luso fruit, jabong, and shaddock after Captain Shaddock. It is the parent of the grapefruit, and the fruit can actually weigh up to 20 pounds. The Chandler is the most common variety, but there's a bunch of others. Chandler is pink flesh, flavorful, usually seedless. Rhine King is white fleshed. Let's take a look at a few more pictures as we go along here and just show people how big these fruit can be. Look at the size of that. That's as big as her head. White flesh, not as sweet as Chandler, seedy. Tahitian is greenish white flesh, moderately acidic flavor with lime overtones. Let's take a look at the next picture, again showing you the size of pomelos. So there you go. Look at the size of that. Just enormous fruit. So very, very interesting. Really fun to grow if you've got the space for it. But they're a full-size tree. And I see them fairly frequently in the San Gabriel Valley because they're very, very popular in the Asian community. And a lot of the various Asian communities, whether they're Chinese or from one of the Southeast Asian countries, Thailand, Vietnam, Malaysia, this is a very popular fruit. And so you see, San Gabriel Valley has a pretty significant population of people who have immigrated from Southeast Asia. And so you see a lot of these trees there. And occasionally I'll get one, bring it home. And typically, though, I guess I'm picking it when it's not ripe because they're not the best fruit to me. I prefer grapefruit. But I would love to grow one of these. Don't get me wrong. I would love to grow one of these in my garden. Right now, I have no citrus in my garden. My Washington navel died a year ago, almost 2 years ago, from oak root rot fungus. And maybe we'll talk about that too in a minute if we have time. But let's talk about mandarin oranges, Citrus reticulata, also known as satsuma or tangerine. So if you hear mandarin or tangerine, tangerines and mandarins are the same thing. It is a large and diverse group, many varieties and hybrids. So clementine is one of the very popular tangerines or mandarins. It is larger than Dancy, late fall to early winter, juicy, sweet, good for cooler areas. The Dancy is the standard tangerine, so Dancy's are the industry standard. Best in hotter areas, zones 12 to 13, good in zones 21 through 23, late fall to winter. So look up your zones in your Sunset Western Garden book if you're not sure. I'm in probably zone 18 or 19, and I live in Pasadena, or the Pasadena area, I should say. 24 is right along the coast. 23 is just in from 24 along the coast. So, and 12 and 13 is actually, I'm surprised that 12 and 13 is listed there because those are pretty cold zones. Encore is another mandarin, and there are a bunch of mandarins. I can't tell you all the varieties. There's lots of them. But the Encore is a light orange, thin-skinned, ripens in summer. So these other are all winter fruit. So if you want a summer tangerine, you might go with Encore. Now let's talk about the Tangelo. This is a hybrid, cross between a mandarin and a grapefruit. So you have it's really a tangerine grapefruit cross are the Tangelos. All are best in warm summer areas. There's a handful of varieties. Mineola is the hybrid between Dancy mandarin and white flesh grapefruit. Large, smooth, bright orange, red fruit, tastes like a mandarin. Let's bring up our next picture. Oh, here it is. Bring this up full screen because this will really tell you. The Mineola has this really distinct kind of nipple right there. You see that? That's really distinct for the Mineola, for Tangelos. So the Mineola tastes like a mandarin, stores on tree for 2 months, mid to late winter for ripening. Orlando, same parents as Mineola, medium-large fruit, looks like a flattened orange. And so I don't have a picture of that. The rind and flesh are orange, matures early in the season. And Wikiwa is a pink Tangelo, lavender gem, A cross between a tangelo and a grapefruit. Looks like small grapefruit, tastes like a mix of sweet orange grapefruit and mandarin. So that's, boy, you know, if I had, you know, a couple acres, I'd probably grow all of these if I could. Well, we've hit the top of the hour. It's where we like to take a little break, remind you of where we're broadcasting from. We're broadcasting from Cal State University Dominguez Hills. It's a spectacular university, a wonderful campus. So let's take a look at the station identification. When we come back, we'll talk more about citrus, and we'll talk more about citrus pests. And if you've got a question, give us a call. Let's take a look at this short video clip.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Maybe you know how to use some of these platforms, but do you know how to make them work for your business interests? Most programs tell you to start with great content, but do they tell you how to create that great content? Creating effective content that can build a viral momentum is the hardest part of social media marketing. That's where we come in. The certificate program in social media strategies and content marketing is a content-based course of study. During this 48-hour intensive immersion program, you will learn how to understand why some content goes viral while other content fails to gain traction. Identify your target audience, connect with them, and build them into a community. Create content that is specifically designed to inspire a positive emotional response and encourage engagement with your target audience. Distribute your content across the social platforms that are most appropriate for your specific goals. Become a thought leader in your area of expertise. This program is designed to help business owners, artists, and other creatives promote their professional ventures. If you're employed in public relations, advertising, marketing, journalism, publishing, education, or government affairs, this certificate can give you a professional edge toward promotions. If you're seeking employment in these areas, this certificate will let corporate recruiters know that you understand the importance of social media literacy. Enroll now.
My name is Zanaya Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you.
It all comes back to this question, right? How do we define humanity?
One of the ultimate sets of values that the humanities program could bring to the future students is really lifelong learning tools that are just applicable in so many ways. I think what Hux 2.0 is doing is really going out of its way to celebrate through a theme, through the cohort theme, a multidisciplinary approach to some of these questions.
What is the advantage of having a graduate program in the humanities? I think as an undergraduate, you're still getting your bearings, right? You're learning the basics of the disciplines. But in graduate study, you know, both of our anecdotes are about, you know, being able to kind of do more with that once you have the foundations.
You can think of these courses not so much as just the core that everybody has to go through, but instead think of it, this is the basis for you to expand, for you to explore the things that you find interesting. But you will have a connection with the other students so that you can have some sort of starting point for those conversations to continue.
The benefits of this model involves the faculty, because we can be closer to one another, mm-hmm. and we're going through the cohort theme with the students, so there's a nice continuity for us.
The theme, thematic approach, and building through a, you know, a fairly tight structure of courses towards a culmination in the symposium allows us to really program not just our own individual classes, but think together about how we're programming a course of study.
All kinds of career choices that future HUC students will choose, I think there's a well-roundedness that the humanities disciplines bring to that ongoing process that never seems quite finalized because it can't be.
Well, I think we are excited about this, and I hope you caught a little bit of our excitement. We hope you can join us if this is the kind of program that you find interesting, and we look forward to working with you this fall and on through the terms, the five terms of this program.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Well, so there you go, Cal State Dominguez Hills, wonderful campus, centrally located in Carson. Great soccer matches in the big stadium, so lots of stuff to do here on campus. Give us a call if you have any questions about your garden, 1-800-339-1193. This is Gardens of California. It's a live television broadcast where you can either call us in or email us a question at askdhtvlive@gmail.com. You can send us photographs of your garden, photographs of your trees. You have a tree in your yard, you don't know the name of it, send me a picture. I'll probably recognize it. Might not, but most likely I will. So we're talking about citrus today. We're closing in on all these different varieties of citrus, some interesting ones. We just talked about Tangelo. Now we're going to talk about Tangor. And Tangor is a hybrid between mandarin and sweet orange. Actually, you just keep crossing these various things and you get slightly different fruit. So the Tangor is a hybrid between mandarin and sweet orange, often labeled as an orange in markets. Three Tangors are thought to be naturally occurring. Temple, grown in low desert, flattened, deep, bright orange fruit with loose skin, ripens in early spring, a bushy and thorny tree to 12 feet. The Murcott bears heavily in alternate years, very sweet and seedy, sold as honey tangerine. And Ortanquique, sweet, juicy, seedy, ripens from spring to summer, large spreading tree. Now, anytime you hear seedy, you know, they're not that popular. People don't like seedy fruit. You know, it just is a pain when you eat it. So, you know, if you've got the space and you're big into citrus, these are great stuff to grow. But you're probably going to want to grow navels. You probably want to have a Valencia so you have summer fruit. You want a lemon. You want a lime. So if you've got space for four trees, and you can get semi-dwarfs, so they're not so big. You don't have to. You know, most of this stuff can be on semi-dwarf or dwarf rootstock. One of the rootstocks is called Flying Dragon. When you graft onto Flying Dragon, you get a very small tree. It grows very slowly. So that's kind of, you have a lot of patience to grow your tree. They're not going to get very big very fast. That's how they get dwarfed. But there are genetic dwarfs and there are semi-dwarfs. So think about semi-dwarfs for if you have limited space. Now let's talk about the kumquat. Let's take a look at our next picture. This is the Dagami kumquat. Bring it up full screen. And kumquats have the best cold tolerance. They can take temperatures down into the teens and not be killed. Whereas most citrus, once you get down in below 32, when you get down to 29 or 28, you're going to have fruit damage. The fruit's going to freeze and it's going to ruin the fruit. You keep going, you get to 25, 23, 22, you're going to start freezing leaves and branches are going to be killed. You get below 20 and you can kill trees. And there's a big difference between how the trees respond to cold in Florida and California, and there's a good reason for that. In California, we start getting cold nights. Last night was fairly cool. As we go into later into October, into November, the nights get colder and colder and colder, and we slowly get colder at night. And trees, many trees, respond to that by putting more sugars in their branches and in the bark and in the leaves. And that acts like an antifreeze. So they harden off to the cold weather as it slowly approaches in Southern California and in all the whole state. In Florida, that doesn't happen. They are warm. They have warm nights, and it's warm, 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 warm all the way into December, all the way maybe the first week of January. It's still warm at night. And then they get a very cold storm coming down the eastern seaboard, and they get freezing temperatures in the 20s. And just a week before, they were in the 70s with lows in the 50s or even the 40s. And they go from, you know, not very cold at all to very cold. And the tree does not get a chance to harden off. And you'll get a hard frost that will kill trees because they aren't hardened off. So that's a very big difference between what happens in Florida when they get severe cold and what happens in California. So typically when we get hard freezes in California, we'll get frost damage, but it doesn't kill the trees, unless they're very small, newly planted trees, and then you can lose your whole tree. If we get really cold, you can kill even a large tree. But typically what you do is get a lot of frost damage where a bunch of the branches are damaged. What do you do after frost damage? You wait until the tree starts to grow back, and you prune back to the new growth. You don't know how much of the frost, how badly the frost killed the tissue or the branches and the leaves until later in the year, until probably April or May or even June. You want to wait and see where the new growth is coming and then prune out that dead wood from the frost in the winter. So this is kumquat. Did we bring this up full screen? Get a look at the leaves. This is a shrub to small tree with yellow to red orange fruits that look like tiny oranges. The rind is sweet, the pulp is tangy, and the fruit is eaten whole. Take a look at the next picture. The best in areas with warm to hot summers and chilly nights during fall or winter. So here's your one of your kumquats. Hardy to 18 degrees Fahrenheit, so no other citrus will take that kind of cold. You can grow this up in Altadena, you will get no frost damage. Whereas if you had some of the others, you might periodically get frost damage. Let's talk about the different varieties. The Nagami is the main commercial variety, oval, thornless, slightly seedy, more abundant and sweeter in hot summer climates. The Miwa is round, and I think this is Miwa we see here. Sweeter, juicier, less seedy than other varieties, good for cooler areas, nearly thornless. And then the Fukushu is large oval with prominent neck. Skin and juice are sweet, not as sweet as Miwa, compact and thornless. And then we've got some kumquat hybrids, the lime quat. The lime quat is a Mexican lime and kumquat hybrid, cold tolerant, good lime substitute. And the varieties are Eustace, bears fruit shaped like a big olive. The Tavares has elongated fruit. The orange quat is a cross between an orange and a kumquat. And Nippon is the most commonly grown, cross between Miwa kumquat and Satsuma mandarin, actually. And they are small, round fruit, deep orange with sweet, spongy rind and slightly acidic flesh, sweeter than a kumquat. Now, the next is Citrus medica, which is the citron. This is an original species of citrus, at least believed to be a citrus, a pure species. Oldest known citrus fruit to be cultivated. Take a look at our picture. Here is the typical citron, a rather large fruit. Grown for thick rind, candied and used in fruitcakes, very fragrant. From ancient through medieval times, the citron was used mainly for medical purposes to combat against seasickness, pulmonary troubles, intestinal ailments, and other disorders. Now, if we take a look at the next picture, this is a citron. It's also called etrog. And it is used in Jewish religious rituals during the Feast of the Tabernacles. And then the other one that you saw earlier in that film clip is called Buddha's Hand. Take a look at the next picture. Shows kind of an information sheet for the Buddha's Hand. And they're calling this fingered citron, citrus medica, which is just citron, but also known as Buddha's Hand, if you read that there. And here's the fruit there. And here's the small shrub that you can purchase. A fruit developed into fingers that are all rind, no frost tolerance, but it is deciduous. And the fruit resembles a big warty lemon when dry pulp. So let's take a look at the next picture. We'll show you a couple of Buddha's hands. There you see one. For no other reason to grow this, this is the most bizarre fruit I've ever seen. It's just incredible. Take a look at the next picture. Almost looks like an octopus, doesn't it? Look at that. It's just spectacular. And the scent is out of this world. So let's take a look at our last fruit, the Calmodrin X Citrofotinella mitis. This is a hybrid species in the genera Citrofotinella, and unknown in the wild. So a Calmodrin. Now let's talk about pests. Well, I'll tell you what. Let's go back to our film clip, because we're moving along in the show and I'd like to show you some of these clips. Let's go to, this is the finish up the first clip we had at the citrus germplasm repository, where they've got 1,100 varieties of citrus. So let's take a look at the end of our first clip.
Country. We're looking at a couple of other of the species that are maintained in the variety collection include things besides citrus, what we call the citrus relatives. These are all in the same family as citrus, but there's a lot of times distinctly different. This is Agli marmalose, also called bale fruit in India. And this is a small one. These things will get to be about twice as big sometimes. This one's immature, but these have a hard shell. So I couldn't even cut it with this knife if I tried to. In order to get seeds out of them for our scientific work, we have to beat on them with a hammer until they crack open.
Really?
And they're also full of a sticky, like, mucilaginous matrix inside. And these are actually used in India to make a drink out of the interior goop, if you want to call it that, which is full of sugars.
Interesting.
And to the right here, we have Maria paniculata, also called orange jessamine. And this is planted a lot in various areas as an ornamental. It does very well here in Southern California, in Florida, in Hawaii. It's very fragrant and aromatic, has beautiful flowers, and produces, in next spring anyway, some small, well, here's a fruit. Here's a very, well, that one fell off, but it produces this very small red or orange fruit. There, Tom's got it. This is a citron. This is a Yemen citron, and the citron is interesting for a couple of reasons. This is citrons were the first type of citrus fruit to get from Asia, from India and China, over to Europe in that area, and the scientific name is Citrus medica. Medica refers to an old name for Persia, so these were established in Persia after leaving India, but before getting to Europe. And these are used by the Jewish people in religious ceremonies, and they look for specific characteristics, which, let's see if we can get this cut open. So some of the citrons have a small amount of flesh in them, but the Yemen and some of the other types are interesting because they have no flesh, as with the Buddha's hand we saw earlier. And so again, this one, you can, you know, sample a small piece of the rind, and it, but anyway, these are some of the characteristics that are considered important for the ritual use of the citron. And there are certain areas of Morocco where some of the rabbis from New York go every year to collect the citron fruits from specific growers over there that have these really desirable characteristics. So one of the things we've done recently is acquire some citrons as seedlings from Morocco that we think will produce a type of fruit that is desired, and we can maintain it then as a propagation source and maybe get a source here in the U.S. Although I'm sure everybody would like to visit Morocco anyway.
Yeah, sounds like a good excuse for a trip.
Yeah.
So, just to finish up that clip, now let's talk about some of the things that kill citrus and hurt citrus. I see we have a call. Let's go to our caller, and then we'll move on from there. Okay, Terry calling from Pasadena. You're on the air. You there, Terry? Oh, did we lose her? Hello? Well, let's see if we'll get her back. If not, we'll got a lot to talk about citrus. So let's see here. I guess I really don't have notes specifically, because I really don't need them when I talk about diseases, because that's my main thing. So let's bring up this next picture. Oh, I see we do have a caller back. Let's see, is this, yes, Terry from Pasadena, you're calling, you're on the air. How can I help you? Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Hello, what's your question today?
I had a question about my orange tree, and I want to plant an orange tree, and I wanted to know if I need to put gravel on the bottom of the hole when I plant.
Oh, that's a good question, because, you know, a lot of people think that you should do that to increase drainage. Unfortunately, you get the exact opposite from that, because you have to understand how water moves in the soil. Water moves in the soil from the small pores, from the large pores to the small pores by capillary action. So it doesn't move from small pores to large pores. So if you take your new tree and you dig your hole, it should be a little shallower than the size of the root ball. You want the top of the root ball about an inch to stick up above the soil grade. You don't want the regular soil to cover up the root ball. And then you want that root ball to actually have good contact with the natural soil everywhere. If you put a layer of gravel in the bottom of the hole, it will actually prevent drainage, because the smaller pores in the regular soil and in the root ball will not drain to the large pores in the gravel. And when you water it, it'll actually start going around the gravel before it'll go through the gravel. So no, never put gravel in the bottom of a hole when planting a tree, a new fruit tree, or any tree or shrub. What you want to do is dig a hole as deep as the root ball and twice as wide. You want a big wide hole where you break up the soil and make it, you know, loose. And then you put that plant in there with the root ball sticking up about an inch, and then give it a good soak and make a berm or a little, dam in a big circle around the tree. So you have a well that you can fill up once a week for the first year to 2 years. That's the easiest way to water a new fruit tree without using sprinklers, but you could use a sprinkler too if you wanted. That first year and a half or so, you're gonna water once a week. You don't need to water in the winter if it rains, of course. But after about a year and a half, you're gonna switch to every 2 weeks in the spring and the fall and once a week in the summer. After 3 or 4, maybe 5 years, and the tree is growing and established and really taking off, you can start watering once a month in the spring and the fall and every 2 weeks in the summer. But no gravel on the bottom of the hole. That's an old, old thing that it may seem logical, but it actually impedes water drainage by putting gravel in the bottom of the hole. Okay?
Okay, well, thank you so much.
Okay, thank you for the call.
Okay, bye.
Thank you for watching the show. Yeah, you know, there's some good videos on YouTube that really demonstrate this, where they take a layer of regular soil, a layer of sand, and then a layer of regular soil, and they start dripping water on the regular soil. And slowly that regular soil gets wet, and then it hits the sand, the water gets to the sand, and then it just stops going down, and it just gets wider and wider. Finally, when it's totally saturated, it starts to get into the sand. I mean, into the larger poured sand, as opposed to what might be a loam or even a clay. It's really important not to put anything in the bottom of the hole. And do not dig the hole really deep and then throw soil back in, because that soil will settle and the root ball will settle and it'll end up below grade. So make sure your plant stays above grade by about an inch. And then you can put a thick layer of compost all over the surface and on the surface of the root ball itself too, but not up against the trunk. And then good deep soak once a week for the first year, year and a half, even up to 2 years. And then once you see that the tree is really established, usually when you plant a new tree, it doesn't really grow a lot of foliage for about a year anyway. It's mostly going to be growing roots. It's going to try and get some roots going in the soil, and it's going to grow less foliage. Once you see a real good break and new growth in the shoots, that's really telling you you've got root establishment, and now you can start transitioning to watering more like a mature tree. So in that second or third year, you're going to be watering every 2 weeks in the spring and the fall, and once a week in July, August, September when it's hot. Maybe continue that once a week through October if we're really hot. But then after you finally get established, your tree's 5 years old, 6, 7 years old, you're going to start watering once a month in the spring and the fall and every 2 weeks in the summer. I can't tell you how many people call me up and their trees are doing poorly. And when they tell me how they water, that's the whole problem. They water for a few minutes every day. That water is about a half an inch of soil, a quarter inch of soil maybe, and then that just evaporates and dries. and the tree's seeing almost no water. So the tree's incredibly drought stressed. You've got to deep water fruit trees. So you water for, if you have that big basin, when you water that tree, you fill up that basin three times. Fill it up, brim full, leave the hose trickling in there, come back in a half hour, fill it up again. Come back in a half hour, fill it up again, you know. And so get a deep soak and then let it dry for 2 to 4 weeks. Now let's go on to our next picture in our series of photographs. And this is Armillaria mellea. Bring it up full screen. This is the oak root rot fungus. This is a picture from my backyard. And Armillaria is the oak root rot fungus. It makes mushrooms in December and January. And this is what killed my navel orange in my backyard. And it has, I don't know if you can see it, there's a little annulus there, then an annulus there. That's the ring. Mushrooms, you know, they have a cap like this. If they've got a ring on them, this is the ring right here. That's the annulus or ring. And then all the stems are united at the base. So if they come up in December, January, they're light tan, like this color, and they've got that annulus and they have a white spore print, and it's coming up at the base of a dead plant, you absolutely can be sure you have Armillaria mellea. Let's take a look at the next picture and we'll look at the annulus a little bit here. Here you can see the annulus very high up on the stem. The other thing about Armillaria is the gills actually run down the stem just a little bit. It's called decurrent. They're not free. They actually, here's your stem and here's your cap and like this, and the gills run down the stem just a little bit. So they're decurrent. And the next, let's take a look at the next one, again showing you the mushrooms. And you can see there, it's a clump of mushrooms. All the stems are united at the base, annulus, white gills. And if you cut off the cap and put it on a piece of paper and then cover it with something, the spores fall down and land on the paper and they're going to be creamy white. That's the spore print. That's the first step in identifying a mushroom. The other diagnostic characteristic for oak root rot fungus is the mycelial fan you find under the bark. So now this will kill citrus, but it has a huge host range. Take a look at this next picture. This is probably off of Italian cypress. And so this is the tree died and they brought it into the lab, and you peel off the bark, and this is probably a root, and you find this white growth directly under the bark. And this is called a mycelial fan or mycelial plaque, and this is diagnostic for Armillaria mellea, the oak root rot fungus. So that was killing their trees. In that particular instance, they kept planting these Italian cypress in this planter bed, and they would live for 3 or 4 years, and then they would die, and they would put another one in, and put another one in. And so they finally brought it in, and I said, well, you have oak root rot fungus. You can't grow those there. You're going to have to grow something that has almost complete resistance. And you can't eradicate it, and there's no chemical control. Now, another important pest, let's take a look at this next one, is the Diaprepes root weevil. This is the adult weevil right here. And I don't think I've got pictures of the other life stages, but mostly it's the larva and the grub that eat on the roots. But here's the adult. It's going to feed on the leaves, and it's going to scallop the leaves. Like if you have a leaf like this, it's going to come in and eat the edges, and so it'll be all scalloped. And then it's going to lay eggs all over the leaves. They're going to hatch. And when they hatch, the eggs probably actually fall off, or the new larvae fall off and land on the ground. And they burrow into the ground and feed on the roots. And you've got a root like this. And they feed on like a spiral, like this. And they put these grooves in it. And if you've got a lemon tree that's got a lot of activity with the Diaprepes root weevil, then you can just walk up and push it over. There's so much root damage from this. So they're feeding on the roots. These larvae are feeding on the roots. And then they come up and they pupate at the surface of the soil. And then they, so out of that pupal case will come the adult weevil you see right here. And they'll come out of the ground. And you'll see little exit holes in the soil. And the adult will walk up the trunk of whatever tree, it doesn't feed on just citrus, by the way. This particular beetle, which is a weevil, feeds on a wide host of things, some palms, coral trees. In fact, we first found it on coral trees in Long Beach, about 10 years ago. And there was a quarantine for it, and there was a lot of activity, and then it kept spreading, and the quarantine was ended because it was too late. It couldn't handle it anymore. We had other important pests to go on to work on. So this is a citrus root weevil. And so that adult beetle will come out of the ground, start, it'll walk right up the trunk, get up into the foliage and start feeding into the foliage, lay the eggs end up in the soil, and that's the life cycle. So that's the citrus root weevil. About the only way to really control it is probably with a systemic, but it's not that widely distributed. I've not seen it outside of the Long Beach area and some spots in Orange County, but it probably will continue to spread. Now, the next one we want to look at is the citrus leaf miner. Let's go to our next picture and bring that up full screen. And you can see the damage here. You see this little white line right here where it's doing this? That's actually poop from the caterpillar. So this is damage from the citrus leaf miner. It is a moth. The moths fly around at night, lay their eggs. The eggs hatch. The caterpillar goes inside the leaf and feeds inside the leaf and causes this twisting and curling. Let's take a look at the next picture. And you can see you see this? It started right here. See how small it is right there? And then, so it went into the leaf here. It started feeding. It's getting bigger and bigger and bigger. It gets to here, it pupates and flies off as a little moth. Okay, so let's take a look at the moth. I'm sorry. Take a look at the moth. This is the citrus leaf miner, the adult moth. It is really tiny. It flies at night. You're not going to see it. Let's take a look at some more damage. Just these next two pictures. This is citrus leaf miner damage. This is your white line. You see that little white line? That's actually the caterpillar pooping. That's where that white line comes from. So this serpentine or snake-like pattern in the leaf, distortion of the leaves. It starts around June. Your spring flush will have no leaf miner activity. Take a look at the next picture. And we'll, just to give you another look at what it looks like. And there is the caterpillar right there. You see it? There it is, right there. Right there. That's the caterpillar. He's probably just about to pupate and emerge as an adult. Let's take a look. And I brought in a little leaf here. Let's go to the overhead real quick. Come back to me and we'll go to the overhead. And this is a little cutting off a bear's lime. And I just wanted to show it to you right here. Let's go to the overhead. Because I get a lot of calls on this. And it's too cold in the spring for the adults to be flying. But you can see the kind of distorted foliage. It's twisted and contorted. And if you look closely, you know, you'll see that there's serpentine. You see that little white line. Actually, the picture showed it better. But there's a little white line and serpentine pattern. And it also kind of gets this clear, shiny kind of thing to it that you can see there. And it looks like it's covered with a little bit of saran wrap or something. So it gets that translucent look to it. The leaf is twisted and curled. It starts around mid-June to early July. You can control this with spinosad, which is organically registered. Spinosad is registered for chewing. It controls chewing insects and leaf miners, so beetles, grasshoppers, caterpillars, leaf miners, regardless of what kind of leaf miner it is. Spinosad is used in a lot of products. So this is the actual damage you see. And almost every citrus tree I see in Southern California has it, unless you're spraying for it. You have to spray fairly frequently. Come on back to me. So if you want to control citrus leaf miner, and you should control it on newly planted trees, on old established trees, you can ignore it. The tree will look a little ratty. If you want to control it, you got to start spraying around June 15th. You're going to spray with spinosad. You're going to spray every 10 to 14 days. If you want 100% control, spray every 10 days. It has a 10-day residual. If you want to get pretty good control, but spray a little less, you can spray probably every 2 weeks, and you probably get very similar control, but you might get a little bit of leaf miner activity. But you're going to have to spray so that once on June 15th, then you're going to spray about July 1st, July 15th, then you're going to want to spray August 1st, August 15th, September, and then two more times in September, seven sprays, and maybe you don't even need the two in September, because as soon as the leaves harden off, fully mature, that only goes to the soft new growth. When those leaves fully expand and harden off and are no longer tender new leaves, then they won't get any leaf miner. So as soon as you see that, you don't need to spray anymore. So you need at least five sprays, one in June, two in July, two in August. And you might need one or two more in September, but then you're done. And so you should do this on newly planted trees because it can slow their establishment if you don't. But don't prune off the infested foliage. A lot of infested foliage, I said. It's not infected, it's infested. It's important to note. But any so, there's no point in pruning off the foliage. A lot of people call up and they say, "Oh, I'm going to prune it all off." No, no, the leaves are still green. They're still making food. Don't prune it off. Usually, the moth is gone. It's finished feeding. It's pupated. It flew away. So now you're just cutting off a green leaf. And if you got, you know, you don't really don't have extra leaves. You want your green leaves. Let's take a look at probably the most important pest, and the one that you almost certainly heard about, is the Asian citrus psyllid. And let's take a look at a few pictures of this, and I'll tell you what's going on. This is the Asian citrus psyllid. This is the vector for citrus greening, or HLB, Wanglong Bing disease. And that is a fatal disease of citrus. And it is wiping out the citrus industry in Florida. It has been a disaster in Brazil. And it is beginning to be a disaster in California. Now, the interesting thing is, this angle right there. Psyllids actually have their mouth parts in their chest right here. So when they feed, they have to push this down against the thing. And when they do it, it shoves up his rear end. So that's an interesting thing about psyllids. And that's why it has that angle of attachment when it's feeding. Look at this next picture. And you'll again see that the psyllids have this 45 degree angle that they hold their body when they're standing on the branch or a twig. Let's take a look at number 38. And see if we can get that picture up. There you go. You see this, again, that angle right there. If you see that, and you got this mottled gray wings, and this is from larva. You see, that's a larva right there. And the larva produce these waxy growths. So let's take a look at the next picture. And it shows you the waxy, the wax that is produced by the young psyllids. These are the instars, or the larval forms. And they are on, where are they? They're at the tips. They're on the soft new growth. And so if you spray, you know, things like soap and oil, you can actually get rid of these. You could use soap and oil and a pyrethrin, and that would probably work pretty good. Now, now that's just the psyllid. The psyllid, it has to have the bacteria, Candidactus libiobacteria, the bacteria that causes citrus greening. So a lot of times people say, oh, the psyllid causes citrus greening. No, the psyllid doesn't cause citrus greening. The bacteria causes the disease. The psyllid is a vector. Just like a mosquito doesn't cause malaria, the infectious agent causes malaria, and the mosquito is a vector, a very important vector, because it's the only way to move the disease from tree to tree. So if you can keep these off your tree, you got a better chance of not getting citrus greening. But that being said, it's kind of a challenge to keep them off your tree. Now, once you're infected, what are you looking for? Let's take a look at some pictures on citrus greening. And I'll tell you, it might be coming to a neighborhood near you because we are now having more and more trees found infected in the San Gabriel Valley. So you see these yellowing branches. That's why it's called Wanglong Bing, or yellow dragon disease. Now the thing is, take a look at the next picture and it'll show it a little better. Is the mottled yellowing on the foliage. Take a look at our next picture and it's asymmetrical. It is not the same on opposite sides of the leaf. If it were symmetrical, then it would be more likely to be a nutrient deficiency and not the disease Wanglong Bing. So if you take a look at this right here, you can see if this were a mirror, you see this is all completely yellow and you've got a bunch of islands in here of green. So it's not symmetrical, although that one looks pretty symmetrical. But typically when you see nutrient deficiencies, it's absolutely symmetrical, like mirror images on opposite sides of the leaf. And here, you can see it's more green than it is over here. Or it's, you know, more yellowing actually on this side. So asymmetrical modeling of the leaf. Let's skip our 42 and go on to 43 because we've already seen the adult. So 43 shows you the fruit. Now what happens when you have citrus greening is the fruit becomes misshapen. It becomes oblong instead of spherical. So you can see this side is smaller than that side. And here, you know, this is the big side, here's the small side. And so your fruit becomes misshapen. And take a look at the next picture. And you see the uneven ripening of the fruit. The top of the fruit will color up and the bottom stays green. That's why we call this disease citrus greening, for this symptom on the fruit, where you have uneven maturation of the fruit. So that's citrus greening. And let's just talk about it for a minute, because how did it get here? What's the consequences? This is the biggest challenge to growing citrus ever. in California or wherever it shows up. Florida has lost 250,000 acres of citrus to citrus greening. Their juice production is down 70%. They are facing being wiped out because of this disease. They first got the psyllid in 97. They got the first infected trees either in 2002 or 2003. Here we are, 13 years later, from the first infected trees being found in Florida to them losing 250,000 acres. So that's phenomenal that in 13 years you can lose 200. And they are trying to keep it out of their groves. They are spraying their groves. They are trying to kill the insect. You just can't kill enough of them. There's too many. There are GMO citrus now. There are citrus trees that carry genes from spinach that confer resistance to bacterial diseases in spinach. So two of those genes were cloned. They were put into citrus trees. Those trees are being grown in Florida. They have not become infected with citrus greening. That's the last I heard. Now, I haven't heard anything for a while, so, and it doesn't get a lot of press, and I don't know the people who are doing this work. I don't interact with them. So I don't know the very latest, but that is really the only future for citrus going forward, is GMO citrus that is engineered to be resistant. The other way is there is a tangerine, actually, that has good resistance. But that'll take a long time to breed for resistance from that to all the other citrus, to lemons and limes and oranges. That'll be very difficult, whereas developing what we always called transgenic plant, and now they'll call them genetically modified. So, you know, if I could get one of those, I would plant it in my backyard tomorrow. I have absolutely no problem with GMO crops. They are wholly harmless to humans. They are the future of pest control to a very large extent going forward into the future. If you don't like spraying pesticides out across thousands of acres of cropland, then we need to develop plants that are resistant to the disease, resistant to the insect, whatever it is, and GMO is the way to go. So if you don't like that, give us a call and tell me why you don't like it. Come on, call up. I'm waiting to hear from you. So I'm sure there's some people who hate GMO who want to tell me I'm wrong. Now let's talk about another disease. Oh, well, before I move on to my next disease, let me just tell you that about 5 years ago, we found the first tree with citrus greening was found in Hacienda Heights. It had been grafted with smuggled budwood from Southeast Asia. That's why smuggling is so dangerous. You put a little cutting in your pocket, you hide it in your luggage. You don't know if there's eggs on that cutting. You don't know if it's infected with a disease. You bring it back, you're bringing back insects, you're bringing back diseases, and you're threatening an entire industry. A multi-billion dollar industry is now threatened because somebody was so foolish as to bring back a cutting from Southeast Asia and graft trees in California. And then that graft infected that whole tree. That tree was cut down and destroyed, and that was about 4 or 5 years ago. Last summer, they started finding infected trees in San Gabriel. We're up to 26 trees found and infected with citrus greening in the city of San Gabriel. That is a very bad sign. That means it's established. That means there are many more trees infected. You don't get symptoms for a year after the first. Once the bacteria is introduced and the tree is infected, you're not going to see symptoms for a year. For a year, the psyllids can be feeding on that tree, picking up the bacteria, and moving it to other trees before you even know the tree's infected. You can sample the tree, and you'll get a negative when it's really positive, because you'll sample a branch that's not infected yet. Another branch may be infected already, but you don't know which branch to sample. So a lot of the trees, many of the trees that were found infected to be positive for citrus greening in San Gabriel were negative the first time they were tested and positive later on when they were tested. So the California Department of Food and Agriculture is trying as much as they can to get rid of the infected trees in San Gabriel. But I'm sorry, they're just doomed to failure. It's just the science is so daunting. How do you find every backyard tree that's going to get infected? A lot of people just ignore their trees. They're not spraying in the spring. They're not getting the aphids and the mealybugs and the scale and the whitefly. Okay, so they're not going to get the psyllid. So the psyllids are going to come in. They're going to feed on their tree. If they fed on an infected tree prior to that, they're going to infect your tree. If you want to keep your tree alive, you need to spray your tree. You need to hit your tree in the spring and keep it clean. Keep the insects off your tree. That will buy you time. It may not buy you forever, but what else can you do? Now, what they do for trees to keep them clean is to drench them with imidacloprid, which is a systemic insecticide. It's a neonicotinoid. It will act for 1 year to keep all the insects off the tree, and they spray the foliage with a pyrethrin, and that'll kill all the adults and nymphs that are in the tree. So if you want to keep your tree clean, you're going to need to start spraying, and especially in March, that first week of March or last week of February, when your tree's flushing new growth, get out there and hit it with soaps and oils. If you just want to be purely organic, soaps and oils and a pyrethrin. If you want, if you don't care about being organic, you can use a systemic. You probably want to apply the systemic after you picked all your fruit, so you'll have the least amount in there when you pick your fruit. Imidacloprid does have a 3-month harvest interval when used in commercial ag production. So you want to apply it after you picked all your fruit, and then you won't be picking your fruit again for about a year. And by the time you pick your fruit, it'll be very little or almost none in the fruit itself. But there will be a little bit, probably a very, very small trace amount. But you don't have to use imidacloprid if you spray frequently with oils, soaps, and pyrethrin. Keep the bug off your tree if you want to keep your tree alive. Now let's move on to Tristeza. Tristeza is a virus disease that causes a lot of problems, has historically caused a lot of problems for citrus. If you have sweet orange on sour, orange rootstock, sweet on sour, you are subject to what's called quick decline if your tree gets infected with Tristeza. That name means sadness. It is the sadness disease. Tristeza is a Spanish word meaning sadness. The trees look, well, what happens is the virus disrupts the bud union, the graft union, I should say. And then the roots no longer are getting sugars from the leaves, and the roots starve to death and die. And typically when you have sweet on sour, you get that, it's a really bad reaction. And suddenly a tree that's fully green 1 month is fully brown the next, and it's called quick decline. And that happened in Brazil in the 1920s and 30s, and they lost millions and millions of trees. And so they had to rebuild their entire citrus industry. So this, let's take a look at some of the symptoms of Tristeza. The first thing is stem pitting. Take a look at this picture, bring it up full screen. Stem pitting is, here are the pits. This is caused by Tristeza. You have to strip off the bark to see that. Take a look at the next picture. And this is the virus itself. You see this rod, this flexus rod, it's very long. It's a very large virus. It is phloem limited, means it only occurs in the phloem, which is the sugar conducting tissue. Take a look at this next picture. This is a tree infected with Tristeza. You can see that it's got, you know, thinning canopy. It's doing very poorly. It's kind of thin here. This one was nice and thick, and this one is in decline, and this one has Tristeza. Now, we have a lot of the mild strains of Tristeza. Take a look at this next picture. You also get orange leaf with Tristeza. That's what this is. You get vein clearing. See how the vein is clear right there? That's another symptom of Tristeza in citrus. So there are mild strains. Come on back to me. There are mild strains of Tristeza, and we've got them well established in Southern California. There is an interior state quarantine for Tristeza. You're not allowed to take your citrus out of Southern California and drive them north. So please don't. If you're going to move up north, do not take your citrus with you. It's actually against the law. You're not going to get caught. No one's going to know. But, you know, if we cooperate together, we can prevent the spread of these various diseases and pests. And so I was up in Morro Bay recently, and I was staying at an Airbnb house, and the host had moved from Long Beach and bought the property a year or two earlier and brought with her a bunch of potted citrus. She didn't know anything about a quarantine. 99% of the population has no idea what Tristeza even is, let alone that there's an interior state quarantine that prohibits the movement of Tristeza out of Southern California up into the Central Valley or up north. You know, you can't move plants out of the quarantine zone. So please don't. It's very likely that her plant probably got infected, because we have in Southern California the mild forms of the virus. They don't hurt very much. The trees are virus, but it doesn't really affect them a whole lot. It is the severe stem pitting forms that are really detrimental, and another one called seedling yellows, which really devastates young trees. But also, I mean, the reason they call it seedling yellows is the effect on seedlings, but on adult plants, it's very bad too. So these severe strains are the ones that are really a big problem. Now, let's see what we want to talk about next. I just want to show you a very quick grafting demonstration. We're going to skip all the other videos we had, and I want to go to the last video. This is a grafting citrus demonstration. Let's go ahead and go to that, because a lot of people call me and ask me about grafting. And citrus is fairly easy to graft. You're going to need a rootstock, which means you need a plant that you grew from a seed, or a, you know, like in a 1 gallon, usually you want to get a small plant. You can grow your own seed. Take a seed from, if you just, you know, in your backyard, you want to do something fun, you get some seeds either from Valencia or even a navel or a lemon or anything. Plant those seeds, grow them up. You're going to have to grow them for nearly a year, maybe two. You're going to wait until the stems are about the size of your fingers. Then you can graft that. So let's take a look at how this guy grafts, and then I'll show you some other ways to graft. Let's take a look at this video.
G'day YouTube. Recently I've been asked how I've grafted my oranges and citrus in general, and I'll show you the method today. It's been quite difficult just being able to show you how to graft, just because I'd need both hands to show you. But I've been pruning today, and I thought, hey, this is a good opportunity to show you how to graft it. So all you have to do is just select the right sort of wood and the right sort of branch. And the important thing is that you select new growth, and it still has to be quite green and supple. It has to be hard, and it can't be soft at all. So the growing tip here, that's no good to us. What you need is something down here, and if I can just zoom in, not sure if you can see, but you've got nice fat buds down there, and that's the sort that you need. Now, I've selected a very good piece here, and that's just come off that. All you have to do is cut a tapering edge off that on both sides and then put it on. Now, the important part is the L shape. So it's an L-shaped graft. So what you do is you cut down the length over here, one, and then two, and it forms an upside down L. And what you do is you then hold it like that and you peel it back. And as you can see, you've got a nice pocket there. So if I just lift this up carefully, over there, you see that pocket that you form with that L? So all you do is you lift that over, and then you slip in your signwood, and as you can see there, you've got a nice tapering edge. And if you don't mind, I'll just put this knife down, but I'll take it out just to show you what a tapering edge is. You see that? It's razor thin. And as you can see, it's not really curved, it's a nice straight shape, and even if it does curve, it doesn't really matter, because this isn't like an apple or a pear where it's hardwood. This is actually still soft and it's still living. So even if there's a slight curve to that edge, it doesn't really matter, because the bark on this is very pliable. So the minute you tie it down tightly, what happens is it wraps around all those tiny curves, so it doesn't really matter about the fit so much. But I'll show you over here. So once you've got that L shape, you just slip it in like that, and as you can see, fits in very easily. The L shape ideally has to be longer than an inch, and you should have one or two buds showing at the top. Three's pushing it, but I have been able to graft with three buds, but they take longer to establish. Two is the best. So always remember, leave one and two at the top. And the part that's cut there has to be longer than an inch. If it's not longer than an inch, it's going to take forever to take. So it's going to be just wasting your time. So if you can do an inch or longer on this, and it doesn't really actually matter, this is probably not ideal because you've got three buds onto that short piece of the bit that goes under here. So the best way to do it is so that the bit that is actually binding to the cambium on the parent plant, on the actual rootstock, the best way to do it is so that you have 2/3 below the bark and only 1/3 at the top. And as you can see, if I cut that top bud here, clean off, let me just do that. So this is just for demonstration purposes. I'm not going to be using this. I wouldn't be so rough with cyanwood usually. As you can see, that forms almost a third up here and two thirds below, and that's more ideal. But I didn't realize how using one hand is going to be so difficult. As you can see, once I slip it in, most of that white part is going to be under there. And then what I do is I push it in deeply in there, and then what you do is you bind it tightly, and as you can see, you've got a very good...
Oh, what he's doing is showing you a way to graft a tree that's already growing in the ground. So you've got a good sized tree in your garden. It might be a lemon tree or an orange tree. So you got an orange tree. You want to graft lemon onto it. It'll take really nice. Graft on a lime too. You can go buy these plants at the nursery that have three or four different types of fruit on one tree. But you can do it to a tree in your backyard using that L shape and then slipping it there. But if you want to just graft it the way we kind of normally graft, or the way I graft, is I take a rootstock, like a 1 gallon plant with a seedling with a stem about the size of my finger, and I do what's called a cleft graft. We just have enough time to take a look in the overhead. Let's go to the overhead real quick, and I'll show you. This is in the Sunset Western Garden book with nice diagram about how to do a cleft graft. He was doing what's kind of like budding, kind of an adaptation of budding that you can use on that. But if you take a look at this right here, you can see that you've cut off, you've got this stem that comes off up, and you just cut it off. And you cut off that stem, you split the stem lengthwise, you take your cutting, which would be like this. Here's that, what I showed you earlier, and let me just pluck off the leaves, because you only want to have a couple leaves on it. You cut it on both sides to have this beveled thing, and then you put it in that split in the stem, but you line up the outside here with the outside of that, because you need the vascular cameums to touch. Then the two vascular cameums, the one from the scion and the one from the rootstock, grow together. Now, when you use camellias, I used to graft a lot of camellias. This would be easily grafted onto a rootstock, this piece here. You'd want to only have one leaf. You might even cut this leaf in half. Then you're going to take a knife and you're going to bevel the sides, split your rootstock, put it on the edge, wrap it. And if you want, you can envelop it in a plastic bag for a month or two and then slowly punch holes in it. We're running out of time. I want to thank everybody in the control room next door for coming in and helping put on the show. Next week, we're talking about roses. So I'll see you next week. Until then, happy gardening. See you next week. We'll talk about roses.